If 1100 wheel horsepower in your street-driven R34 Nissan GTR isn't enough to blow your hair back, don't worry, you've still got another 200 horsepower on tap when you press the nitrous button. We're here at World Time Attack's Flying 500 competition with Anthony's WARGTR R34, and we wanted to find out what makes this impressive street-driven GTR so fast. The heart of the car is, of course, the RB32 engine. But getting an RB26 out to 3.2 litres is no mean feat. This actually starts by ditching the factory RB26 block and working with an RB30 block as the base. The rest of it is all based around a Nitto 3.2 litre stroker kit. This includes the Nitto crankshaft, the Nitto conrods, and a set of pistons. Now, the bottom end of the engine is really all about achieving a certain amount of displacement, but also achieving reliability. It's the head as well as the turbocharger that really dictates how much power the engine can make. In this case, the head is a full Croydon Racing Developments race cylinder head. Now, we haven't got too many details on the exact specifics here, but fair to say that with the ability to rev to 9,500 RPM and support around 1,300 wheel horsepower, there's not a lot that hasn't been done to the head. Getting the airflow into that head is the Precision 7685 turbocharger. Now, for a 3.2 litre engine, that 7685 isn't actually considered to be a massive turbocharger. And that's proven by the fact that it can produce full boost by around about 4,500 RPM. Considering the engine revs all the way to 9,500, that's quite a nice wide power band. Now, that full boost point, particularly when the car is being used in competition, is 41 psi. And on the quarter mile, the car's gone as fast as an 8.90. It's important to mention, though, that that was on an unprepped street surface. The highest mile an hour the car's trapped at is over 164 mile an hour, showing that it's certainly making some power considering the fairly heavy weight of the R34 chassis. Once that 7685 is up on boost, all of that air is forced through a Hypertune intercooler front mounted, and then it feeds into a Hypertune plenum chamber. Now, this is one of the areas that's a common change with highly modified RB engines. The factory individual throttle bodies have been ditched, and the Hypertune plenum chamber consists of a single drive-by-wire throttle body. The plenum also houses a set of six Siemens Deka 2400cc injectors that are essential to supply the kind of fuel flow necessary to support that power level when the engine is running on E85 fuel. That drive-by-wire throttle body is a kind of unique change for an R34, which conventionally uses a cable throttle. The drive-by-wire throttle, in conjunction with the MoTeC electronics package, allows for some significant advantages. One of these is the ability to provide an automatic throttle blip on the downshift when changing down gears with the sequential transmission. In terms of that transmission, the car is fitted with a 6-speed Samsonas sequential. Now, this allows, most importantly, clutchless upshifting. And when you've got a reasonably large turbocharger, this is really important to keep that turbo on the boil when the car is going down that quarter mile. The driver can keep his foot pinned on the throttle, and when he pulls back on the gear lever, a strain gauge in the gear lever lets the ECU controlling the engine know that the driver is requesting an upshift, and from here the ECU can perform an ignition cut, a fuel cut, or both to momentarily unload the dogs in the gearbox and allow the next gear to be selected. This provides incredibly fast shifts that are almost imperceivable from the driver's seat. Now, I've alluded to the electronics package a couple of times. Now, we'll get into a little bit more detail about what's involved there. And the heart of the electronics is the MoTeC M150 ECU. This controls, obviously, all of the functions of the engine. It controls the boost pressure, and it also enables those clutchless shifts that we've just talked about, along with the automated blip of that drive-by-wire throttle on the downshifts. The M150 ECU is also connected to a MoTeC C127 dash display unit, and this is a driver display as well as a central logging unit. Completing the MoTeC suite of electronics is the MoTeC PDM, or power distribution module. Now this replaces conventional fuses and relays that we may see in most cars, and all of the circuits or power distribution circuits for the electronics on the engine as well as the chassis are controlled via essentially solid state relays. This allows a lot more flexibility in the fusing and control of those circuits. Now the power distribution module is controlled via a CAN-based keypad, which is located on the transmission tunnel. This allows the driver quick and easy control over all of the functions of the ECU and the dash. One of the challenges with getting fast, consistent launches out of a heavy four-wheel drive drag car is managing clutch slip off the line. Simply sidestepping the clutch actually isn't desired, as this is likely to result in the car either bogging or alternatively launching into uncontrolled wheel spin. Neither of those are going to give you a fast 60-foot time. In this case, Anthony's actually used a trick that's been common in the drag racing market for a number of years. This consists of a Magnus clutch slipper unit. And essentially, this is a valve that's plumbed in line with the clutch line. And what it does is it controls the release rate of the clutch pedal. So this allows a very consistent and repeatable amount of clutch slip when the driver sidesteps the clutch off the line. Now, the downside of this, of course, is because you're creating a lot of slip through first gear, it is going to wear your clutch plates quickly. In this case, the engine is backed by an OS Giken quad plate clutch, giving plenty of clutch material for a reasonable clutch life, even with the slip taken into account. To date, this system has netted Anthony a 60-foot time in the mid-1.4s on a street surface that was unprepped, which is a pretty impressive result. At this stage, we have only gone through the first day in the Flying 500 competition, and unfortunately, Anthony has faced a few issues. It really didn't give him a representative mile an hour at the end of the strip. We're hoping he can resolve those problems overnight, and we're looking forward to seeing how the car goes tomorrow.
If you like that video, make sure you give it a thumbs up, and if you're not already a subscriber, make sure you're subscribed. We release a new video every week. And if you like free stuff, we've got a great deal for you. Click the link in the description to claim your free spot to our next live lesson.